This week on Wealth Track, escaping the bonds of traditional fixed income investing, award-winning fund manager Dan Roberts reveals the strategy secrets of his MainStay Unconstrained Bond Fund in an exclusive interview next on Consuelo Mack Wealth Track.
New York Life, along with MainStay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Luma Sales, investors seeking exceptional opportunities globally. Thornburg Investment Management, active management, global perspective. Rosalind P. Walter and the Fairholme Foundation. Hello and welcome to this edition of WealthTrack. I'm Consuelo Mack. Ever since the financial crisis, we have been talking about the unprecedented steps central banks have taken to pump money into the world's financial system, thereby lowering interest rates and making borrowing more affordable to companies and countries. The trend continues. As you can see from this chart, courtesy of this week's guest, the balance sheets of major central banks have exploded since pre-financial crisis days. Up more than 500% of the Federal Reserve, nearly 500% of the Bank of England, close to 300% of the Bank of Japan, and almost 200% of the European Central Bank. One of the consequences of these policies has been to lower interest rates, which simultaneously drives up the prices of bonds. By just about any measure, bonds are expensive and their yields around the world are historically low. That combination challenges the primary reasons for owning bonds in the first place, for their income and price stability. It also creates a serious dilemma for investors, what to do with their bond portfolios. Well, one answer is to consider non-traditional bond funds, also commonly known as unconstrained. These are fixed income funds that can invest just about anywhere in the world, in many cases can invest in other asset classes like stocks, and can go short. They have become very popular with investors searching for higher returns and protection against an eventual rise in interest rates. According to Morningstar, non-traditional bond fund assets have more than doubled to a record $151 billion last year from $62.5 billion in 2011. This week's guest co-manages one of the highest rated ones. He is Dan Roberts, co-portfolio manager of the MainStay Unconstrained Bond Fund, which carries a 5-star rating by Morningstar and has for the second year in a row received a Lipper Fund Award for its, quote, consistently strong risk-adjusted performance relative to its peers. Roberts, a PhD economist, is the head and chief investment officer of global fixed income at Mackay Shields, which he joined in 2004. But his bond team has been together for more than 20 years and has specialized in managing asset allocation funds, high-yield bond portfolios, and also long-short strategies, which have recently become widely used in that now very popular non-traditional bond fund category. Mackay Shields is a wholly owned but independently run subsidiary of WealthTrack sponsors New York Life MainStay Investments. Roberts is here because of his recognized track record. I began the interview by asking Roberts what difference having an unconstrained bond fund rather than a traditional one makes in today's markets.
When we think about the traditional bond funds and we think about unconstrained, first of all, the differences between the two are that the unconstrained bond fund and the traditional bond fund have different durations.
And durations is interest rate risk, but explain to our audience who might not understand what duration means, what that means.
Yes, so duration is, as interest rates go up or down,
right,
how does that affect the price of the bond? And so a higher duration means that the bond price, as interest rates go up and down, affects the price of the bond more.
Gotcha, so a high duration is not a good thing necessarily because it gets affected more.
Yes.
The price of the bond gets affected more.
If interest rates go up.
Right.
Exactly right. So when you're looking at the differences then, which then we can come on to what are the good things, what do we like about unconstrained? The differences are, number one, is that the durations are different. And generally with the traditional bond fund, the duration of traditional bond funds tend to be 5.5 years or longer, whereas with an unconstrained bond portfolio, it's usually about 0.5 year. So the risk is significantly less. Now, the second major category of difference between the two is the flexibility. With a traditional bond fund, generally traditional bond funds are use the benchmark of the Lehman aggregate or the Barclays aggregate now. And with the Barclays aggregate, those are the sectors in the Barclays aggregate are basically investment grade bonds. Now, many times you will be allowed to invest maybe 10, 20, or 30% outside of the aggregate in other things, in other sectors like emerging markets or high yield or non-dollar bonds.
But always in bonds.
But generally in bonds.
Your long bonds.
Yes,
right.
Exactly. Generally in bonds. Now, with an unconstrained, however, you don't have that constraint of 0 to 30% that you must keep in, or that you can only have in bonds that are outside of the Barclays Act.
So you're limited in a traditional bond fund. Then you're limited to only having up to 30% outside of what's in the Barclays aggregate.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
So that's the only leeway you've really got.
That's right. So what would be one of the natural advantages then? Well, you have all this flexibility.
Right.
As a portfolio manager, you can invest where you see value and you aren't constrained by the 10 or 20 or 30%. I believe that's where the name unconstrained came
right.
from.
And how unconstrained are you with the MainStay Unconstrained Bond Fund, for instance? You know, I mean, you can invest in equities, right?
It's just a very small portion in equities.
Right.
Where we have most of the flexibility is in typical bonds. So in, you know, investment grade, in high yield, in emerging markets, those. You know, obviously, treasuries, investment grade corporates. So we do have a lot of ability to move among bond sectors. We have a little bit. We have a little bit. Our ability is just a small amount with equities, but really not much. It's very, very much focused on bonds.
But also, you can short.
We can.
Right.
We can.
And that you cannot do in a traditional bond fund.
That's right. And the shorting sometimes is very, very useful. Over the last number of years, we haven't used much of the shorting capability. And the reason for that is the market's been going up. Wasn't a good thing to short.
Right.
So we haven't been shorting it. Now we have been doing shorts. However, we've been shorting, for example, the 2-year treasury. Just very recently, we started shorting the 10-year bund.
That's the German sovereign debt, the 10-year note.
That's the German sovereign debt. And the reason that we've been doing that is because of the upside-downside trade-off is so attractive. So let's look at the bund for a second. Mm-hmm. The bund has been trading anywhere recently between, let's say, 5 and 15 basis points. So that means that you really have, if you're short, you don't have a lot of risk to the downside. Even if the bund goes negative, like the rest of the German curve has, you don't have a lot of downside risk, but you have a lot of upside opportunity. And your carry cost is not nearly as expensive as in the US market. One of the things that is important to us in making this kind of decision is what's going on in the European economies right now. And that is the ECB has been very loose. That's one of the reasons why interest rates are negative. Right now,
right.
Is that the
European Central Bank has been done this quantitative easing program. They're buying a ton of bonds.
They're buying a ton of bonds.
Injecting lots of money into
exactly.
financial system.
Exactly right. And when any central bank, including the ECB, tries to stimulate the economy, they work on our markets. They work on the bond markets. And so they've been buying European sovereign bonds. And so they've been buying quite a lot of them, $60 billion a month. And so what we see then is that we see that yield and yield is dropping as prices rise. So that's one of the reasons we have this very negative yields now in Europe, which then is attractive to us, not as a long investment, but as a short investment.
So here we have the European Central Bank is easing, and the Federal Reserve is saying that they're about to start raising rates, which is going to make money a little bit more expensive. How does one adjust to that dynamic?
What's happening now isn't all that peculiar. And that is, if you go back through time and you look at what the ECB was doing from a policy perspective and what the Fed was doing from a policy perspective, and you plot their policy rates, what you'll find is that the Fed leads and always has led.
Oh.
The ECB. So what we're seeing this time is not all that strange. What is strange this time is that the ECB really waited for a long time before they started to react. And when they reacted, they didn't react nearly as much. So they are behind the Fed. And the Bank of England, if you look at the policy rate for the Bank of England, you'll see that it followed the Fed very closely. So what we have is we have the Fed and the Bank of England leading the rest of the world.
And their economy is actually doing better, some say, because of that.
We would agree with that.
You would?
Yes, absolutely. And when you look at Japan and you look at Europe and you look at some of the charts that I believe you've generated, what you see is their monetary stimulus is way behind the US and England's, and their growth has been behind. We don't think that that's random. We think that there's a very close correlation there.
Therefore, in an unconstrained bond fund like you run, what kind of flexibility do you have that a traditional bond fund wouldn't have to take advantage of those two different trends?
So, for example, back in 2009, we started investing in the unconstrained bond fund at the end of 2009, at the beginning of 2010. And what we believed was at that time that when the Fed was easing, that would be very, very stimulative to the U.S. economy.
Right.
That would be good for corporate bondholders. And it would be very good for investment grade corporates. It'd be very good for high yield, particularly good for high yield. So what we did is we put a fair amount of the portfolio into high yield at the beginning of 2010.
And that's, of course, when a lot of people thought that the world was still falling apart.
Exactly.
They didn't believe the recovery.
Exactly.
And therefore, high yield was considered to be high risk.
Exactly. Exactly right. Exactly right. And that's one of the things that's one of the reasons performance is different among managers, isn't it? Or between people.
Right.
We very much believed that high yield represented real value at pretty low risk, actually. Because the Fed was stimulating so much that as they stimulated, as the Fed goes out and they purchase bonds, they raise the price of treasuries, lower the yield of treasuries, and people like us say, yield's too low in treasuries, we need to go to the corporate market, which is what we do. So what happens is we start buying corporate bonds, as does everybody else, that pushes up their price and their yield down too. But if you can get in there first before everybody starts feeling comfortable, you can make a good return on those corporate bonds. And that's what happened with us. And so...
Well, that turned out to be right. But, you know, now fast forward how many years later, and in fact, we've had a decent recovery in the U.S.
Yes.
And you're assuming the recovery is going to continue for several more years, is that...?
Yes, we exactly.
Uh-huh.
And we still really like corporate bonds, and we like them for a number of reasons. Number one is that we get a pretty good yield on that vis-a-vis treasuries or agencies.
Right, a pretty good comparative yield. And also, the real yield, because inflation is so low that you actually get a pretty good yield over inflation too, right?
Exactly.
So that's a good deal for...
It is. People are making real returns.
Yes.
Yes. So number one then is we get a pretty good yield. Number two is default rates are very low, and that's why you get a spread over treasuries with corporates, is to pay you for the default rates. And default rates have been pretty low. And three, particularly in this environment now, what we see is that corporations are doing well. They've refinanced their debt. They're in pretty good shape. And a real kicker for us, something that we think is a real advantage, is that towards the end of this kind of recovery, what we generally see is that as unemployment falls, as capacity utilization rises, is we generally see that inflation starts to creep into the system. And as inflation creeps into the system, it causes nervousness among the central banks. That's why people are thinking the Fed's going to raise rates. So what happens is rates start to rise. Now, what's particularly interesting in the corporate bond arena is corporate bonds are made up of two pieces. They're made up of treasury rates plus spreads that you get for the default. Well, those two pieces, actually, their yields, their interest rates, move in opposite directions in a period like this, in a recovery. So when you look at the overall yield that you get for example, for high yield, those two things are negatively correlated, and high yield then is protected, at least to some extent, against rising rates, which makes it a really very attractive investment at this particular part of the cycle.
But the treasury, if treasury rates are rising,
right,
why does that make high yield more attractive?
Okay, it's because high yield is simply a combination of those two things. You add one of those things, you add interest rates on treasuries to that credit quality
right.
spread you're talking about. You add those two things together.
Oh, now, I see. All right. So that's why they high yield, right.
Exactly. So as in a recovery, as interest rates here, treasury rates, rise,
yes.
the quality spread comes down. And you add those two things together to get high yields, which determines prices of high yield.
Yeah.
And so those two things are moving in opposite directions. That's a wonderful thing. There are very few bonds that we know of that have this built-in negative correlation.
Dan, one thing about high yield is that it's become very popular. A lot of investors in the search for yield have gone into high yield bonds. The high yield, you know, bond sector has done extremely well. How much life does it have left?
Well, high yield spreads today are about 450 basis points. So that's 4.5%. That's a little bit low relative to average, but not very far from average.
And again, that's 4.5% over the equivalent treasury.
Over that treasuries, right.
Yes.
Exactly right. So over treasuries.
Right.
So we aren't that far actually from the average spread. Furthermore, the world economy seems to be picking up some, particularly in Europe. The US, we're doing fine. Europe is starting to pick up some. We know that Japan is following a loose monetary policy. India is following they've lowered rates. We know that the Chinese just recently lowered the reserve requirements by 1%.
Mm-hmm.
So the rest of the world is in stimulus mode. The US is not yet started to raise rates. So the world really is very much in stimulus mode. And what we believe is when the world is in this kind of stimulus mode, what we believe is central banks are still out there buying bonds. They're still driving prices up. People are still running from sovereign bonds, like treasuries,
right,
to corporate bonds. Why they need yield. If you're German and you're getting a negative yield, well, getting a spread over U.S. treasuries is of 450 basis points is pretty attractive.
We keep mentioning treasuries, and one of the things that traditionally treasuries are considered to be the least risky in the bond world, because you're guaranteed to get your money back in maturity. So, but you are saying the opposite, actually, that treasuries are, in fact, what, among the riskiest or the riskiest?
Treasuries have us worried.
Yeah.
Treasuries have us worried. Why? We are entering into a period right now where the Fed is starting to raise rates. And have we seen rates rising over the last several years? at the short end of the curve we have, the two-year rate has in fact gone up.
Right.
Why is that? It's anticipating that the Fed is going to raise rates. So that's one of the reasons why we have shorted the two-year treasury in the U.S.
When is the high yield, when does high yield become less attractive? When do you make that switch from high yield to other types of bonds?
Okay, well, let's talk about in 2006. What we did is we started making that switch. And one of the reasons we made that switch is because we no longer found value in high yield. And we will do the same thing this time. We're not going to hold these high yield bonds forever.
Right.
We don't want to hold them forever. At some point, we'd like to take them to zero if there's no value left. So in 2006, what happened is high yield spreads became very, very narrow. There was, in the credit markets, there was over leveraging going on. We thought the risk, we weren't being compensated, that 250 to 300 basis points that we were getting in the high yield market just didn't compensate us for the risk that we saw in the world. So what did we do? We took our high risk beta or our high yield risk down.
Right.
And that's what we're looking to do this time as well, but not yet.
The traditional view of a bond portfolio is that it provides income and stability. Is that still the case overall in the bond market? Income is pretty low.
Yes.
Stability, if rates start to go up, is going to be, it's going to be less stable, it's going to be more volatile.
Yes.
So what should we expect from a bond portfolio?
Right. Well, you've put your finger right on it. I mean, that's the million-dollar question. And that's what everyone is asking themselves. They're saying, if we back up here for a second, we say the central banks have stimulated so much, they've poured so much money into the bond markets, because the bond markets are the transmission mechanism between the central bank and stimulus. They've bought so many bonds, they've pushed the prices so far up.
Right.
Isn't it risky? And the answer is it is risky.
It is risky.
It is risky, and that's one of the reasons we've come up with the unconstrained bond portfolio,
is to manage that risk.
Is to try to manage that risk. Is to give us the flexibility to manage around that risk, but at the same time, hopefully, trying to give clients a pretty good income at the same time.
My last question is the one investment for a long-term diversified portfolio. Mm-hmm. What should we all own some of in a long-term diversified portfolio?
I think a great investment right now is a currency-hedged European equity portfolio. And the reason we like that is because we think that what the European Central Bank is doing, the ECB is doing, will stimulate the economy. And I go to Europe a lot, and the Europeans are one of the ones that are most skeptical about this. So there are a lot of people believing that this growth, this increase in growth, won't happen. So that creates an environment that we think is very conducive to rising prices in the European equity market.
So Dan Roberts, thank you so much for joining us from Mackay Shields and the MainStay Unconstrained Bond Fund. We really appreciate your being on WealthTrack.
It's just been a pleasure. It's been fun. Thank you very much.
At the close of every WealthTrack, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. It turns out one way to do that is to invest in actively managed bond funds. This week's action point is check out established actively managed bond funds. According to Morningstar, over the last decade, unlike stock fund managers, bond fund managers have outperformed index funds and bond indexes. For instance, the percentage of actively managed intermediate-term bond funds that outperformed the benchmark Barclays U.S. Aggregate Index over the last 3 years was 71%, over the past 5 years was 70%, and over the 10-year periods was 56%. whereas the percentage of actively managed large cap stock funds that outperformed the S&P 500 was only 29% over the last 3 years, 20% over the last 5 years, and 27% over the last decade. As we just discussed with Dan Roberts, bond markets are so huge and complex that human judgment can actually add value. Well, next week, we will be talking to a financial thought leader who always challenges the status quo and is entertaining to boot. Cliff Asness, founder and chief investment officer of alternative investment firm AQR Capital Management, will join us. To see this program again, as well as our exclusive extra feature with Dan Roberts, go to our website, WEALTHTRACK.com, and keep connecting with us on Twitter and Facebook. Thank you for watching, have a great weekend, and make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
New York Life, along with MainStay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Loomis Sales, investors seeking exceptional opportunities globally. Thornburg Investment Management, active management, global perspective. Rosalind P. Walter and the Fairholme Foundation.